Hi, my name is Mike Foley, and today we are talking about Namespace Self-Service here on vSphere Tech Marketing's Quick Bites series of quick and dirty, condensed versions of these new features that are coming out within vSphere. So, Myles, why don't you introduce yourself, and then we'll jump right into it.
Sure. So my name is Myles Gray. I work in tech marketing on vSphere with Tanzu as well, but I focus on the developer experience, so the higher level stuff above the platform.
Cool. All right. And what are we going to be talking about? I hear you are the man to discuss this Namespace self-service that I think for a lot of vSphere admins, when they think of anything self-service, they go, oh, God. Someone might cause a denial of service by trying to take over all of the resources.
So Namespace self-service is one of those things. It's a really, really simple feature, and it's pretty fundamental. And basically, whenever you're using the supervisor cluster as a SRE, as a Kubernetes user, you don't have the ability to spin up your own namespaces. And that was by design. You know, we didn't want users to just go and use up all the resources, right? Like you said, you know, create a denial of service attack type thing and consume everything. So in the initial versions of vSphere with Tanzu, the namespace provisioning was up to the VI admin. Then they handed that off to the SRE team or to the Kubernetes user. That was okay initially, but the more you start to play with these things, you realize that sometimes SREs and Kubernetes users do need to create namespaces themselves. You know, like they do need that ability, or maybe they don't need to create them directly, but something they're installing tries to create a namespace because it needs it. Okay. So, you know, it's a reasonable thing.
As part of, say, a production workflow or something like that. Yeah.
Exactly. It's just, you know, how that application works. So we thought, okay, well, we would like to give them the ability to create namespaces, but how do we do it safely? And how do we do it so that they can't run away and use all the resources? So in 7.0 U2A, we added this namespace self-service feature, and this allows you to define a template inside your vCenter that says, okay, they get this much compute, they get this much memory, they get this much storage, and they can access these storage policies. And basically, that becomes your template for these namespaces. So the developer can go and say, I would like to do, you know, kubectl create namespace test, and it will create the namespace based on that template. So it's still within the realms of what you have laid
out. So that's kind of saying that no one user is ever going to be able to create more a namespace that contains more than 8 virtual CPUs and 512 gigabytes of memory or what have you, right?
Right. You slice it up whatever way you want, but it keeps them nice and cookie cuttered. And usually for these kinds of things, they tend to be quite ephemeral. So, you know, usually maybe lots of smaller ones or whatever than, you know, a couple of big ones is the way you would see this stuff. And you don't expect them to hang around very long. So usually, you know, if you're saying, you know, 8 CPUs, maybe, I don't know, 50 gigs of RAM is plenty for this kind of stuff.
Right, right. Now, from a vSphere admin standpoint, in the vSphere UI, am I going to see all of these different namespaces and who owns them and the resources that are being consumed? And can I do anything additionally as a vSphere admin to these namespaces?
Right. So yes and no. So yes, you do get to see all the namespaces. Yes, you get to see who created them. Yes, you get to see all the resources that are inside of them. You don't have any additional control over these, like, you know, based on what you would have over a standard
like a
namespace.
It's about the same. Like that, right?
Nothing like that right now. But everything else, everything that you would see for a regular namespace, you also get governance over for these namespaces as well. Likewise, you can clean them up if you want to as well. And, you know, you might be thinking, you know, well, if developers can create things, can they delete things as well? And what
do
happens,
they ever?
You know, whenever they...
Well, they can.
Well, they can.
Yeah, but do they ever?
So, no, never. So whenever it comes to, like, life cycle of these namespaces, yes, you as a VI admin can take the reins and deal with that if you need to. But also the developers don't really, like, if they're going to have to log a ticket to have something deleted, you know what's going to happen? it's not going to get deleted, is it? Because they're not going to log a ticket. So they can do a kubectl, you know, delete namespace and their namespace, and away it goes. But it's all based on their ownership of that namespace. So if they try and delete a namespace that you created or a fellow developer created, they can't do that. Likewise, if we've decided, you know, that we're going to turn off this namespace self-service feature, we don't need it, we don't like it, whatever, they can still delete the namespaces they own, but they can't create anymore. So it really does keep them on rail tracks, right? They can't go nuts with
this. I'm pretty sure in the latest version of Power CLI, you could relatively easily write a report of what's in a namespace and output that. And what I have found in the past is probably more valuable than say, okay, after 30 days, I'm going to delete your namespace, is after 30 days, I'm sending you and your manager a list of all the resources that you are consuming, and then let the manager handle that. Because really, at the end of the day, it's not a technical problem, it's a people problem, right?
Right, absolutely, absolutely. Cool. And, you know, it's a very simple feature just designed to solve a very simple problem, but we've done it in our, you know, the enterprise-friendly way that we do, which is ensuring quotas, limits, control.
And so how do folks get this functionality?
So again, just like with VM service, if you watched our VM service video that we did, it'll be in 7.0 U2A. You download the vCenter, or, you know, update your vCenter, update your supervisor cluster after you've updated your vCenter, and it's just there, good to go.
And you have a blog on this, and I'm assuming that blog has a demo showing how it all works, right? All right, we'll put the link to the blog in the show notes and or down below. And so let's see, what's a final question? No, I think that kind of wraps it up. Thanks again for joining us, Myles, and hopefully we'll have a couple more of these coming out pretty soon.
All right.
Thanks, everyone, and see you again soon. Bye-bye.